Yes.
Thank you for a wonderful talk. And I was wondering if you could tell us, or maybe talk about whether there might be a Byzantine influence at play here, because if I think about the great events in the Byzantine world around this Pentecost controversy, where they're so incredibly anxious about figurative representation, especially in the religious context. And these books are written in the religious context with religious material. Might there be something emanating out of the Byzantine world affecting, you know, figurative representation and creating a tendency towards ornamentation.
Thank you. It's an interesting question. I was talking about the restrictions of a book like that. The book that I wrote in the Oxford series was in a series on the art of Western world. And there's a separate series on the non-Western world. And in that, that's where the Byzantine volume is, which is really weird, especially since the book on archaic and classical art in Greece is in the Western world, but Minoan is non-Western. And I was commissioned to avoid the Eastern, in other words, and that made that difficult. The ties are extraordinary. The great monastery at St. Catherine's at Mount Sinai has manuscripts that are not only Greek, they're Georgian, they're Syriac, they're Arabic, they're Latin. They're Greek, and many of them written in and around that region at the time. People are traveling back and forth a lot. There's no question about that. Pardon?
Migration.
They're migrating. But they're not doing it as, you know, peoples. He's teasing me. After 50 years, you can tease me. The problem, again, it's the fragmentary nature of our evidence. One, forgive me my saying so, the question has a little bit of the notion that they decided not to put figures in these manuscripts to make them aniconic so that they retained sensibilities. And I would argue, at least in this period, and I think in a lot of others, we should get away from that, that they're just they're beautiful ornament, they're wonderful. They're not lacking something. The other thing is the chronological priority. These Latin manuscripts from the early 7th century, they are generated before the earliest beginnings of the iconoclastic controversy, per se, and they're before the developed use of minuscule script in Greek manuscripts, which is really about a century later. And a lot of this has to do with the hierarchy of scripts and distinguishing and classifying the text by doing that. The Greek manuscripts, though, they use ornamental headpieces in a lot of ways, so do Syriac manuscripts. Ornament is really important in those, and I think there's a kind of ferment. People see other people's books, and they work well, and they want to learn from that. What's happening digitally now, that people have ideas, and they pick them up, and this happens really pretty rapidly, that the kind of books that are being produced in 650 are radically different from the kind of books being produced at about 750 in many different centers. They're kind of metastasized. Is that?
So, Larry, are we not looking at an 18th and a 19th and 20th century phenomenon where you've got these great books in great centers like the British Museum, like Dublin, and you've got stories that you can wrap around them by English historians, by Irish historians. And they're in major centers, and Luxor, bless its heart, is not in the center of anywhere. I mean, it's I'm just looking at it on the map, and it's sort of, you know, it's in France at the moment, but given up with another war, it's everywhere. And then you've got the scattering of the product across from St. Petersburg to everywhere. There was just no one to be a.
Yeah, that's right.
And the issue is not a racial issue. The issue is an issue of nationalism.
Well, but those two concepts get linked in a lot of. I mean, Donald Trump didn't invent putting those two things together. But one thing about being in centers. If you look at the map again. Luxor is absolutely in the center. The Loire rises within sort of 50 kilometers, so does the Seine, so does the Saône. This is the place, the perfect place to organize whereby you can use your transport to go in all sorts of different directions. But you know, there's a prison there now or something like that. We're blinded often by our own perceptions of what are major centers. You know, looks like it was really important in the 7th century, and you can see that in reading the historical material too. But as for, I worry, I probably shouldn't say this, I worry about nationalism often being a stalking horse for nastier. And the notion of the modern nation state as somehow ethnically pure. And we hear this in the contemporary political discourse here about, you know, real Americans are not immigrants from someplace else. But to be overtly racialist or racist is not acceptable in most polite company, but to be overtly nationalist is. And I worry that these things really are, I have to confess.
Of a design thing, of a very, very carefully made artifact, that step interests me very much. And the figure always remains inside of it. Mm-hmm. By the comparanda that you were showing, you are putting this with other kinds of artifacts, like the Gotham carving, the architectural. Would you care to talk a little more about this artifactual sense?
Well, books are, they're physical objects, and these particular books, I mean, they're on animal skins, for heaven's sakes. And people know that. The production of a book like this and the manufacture of the pigments used, the inks and things like that, are complex mechanisms sort of brought together to make this kind of thing possible. The the ruling and the binding and everything that's happening in these. And you can see it's an exciting sort of exploration of what are the possibilities for this sort of form. What happens when we condense what would have been 12 rolls in a Roman library into a single volume that you can page back and forth in? You can carry in your pocket when you go someplace, when you're teaching. On the other hand, it's much harder in a way to find a particular place because it's too big. So how am I going to find my way around this? I mean, I'm still staggered by the fact that they didn't think of page numbers. Yeah. Why did they think of just numbering the pages in these early medieval manuscripts? They numbered the choirs, but Will is passing on this one. If it ever happens, it's very, very rare. And So that artifactual side is certainly one of them. But in terms of the other side of the, well, ornament too, if you look at Church's Betsy Bowman at Temple, her excavations in the fantastic red church, and the other monasteries that she's excavated, and you've excavated off the filth of smoke, and you find these brilliant colors. All the surfaces are just covered with ornament. And focusing on just the few, oh, there's a saint here and there's a saint there, really misses much of the point. It's that sort of kinesthetic experience. Are we going to be talking about something like that later? Of the many senses, which is, many people are studying now a lot, this is really part of that. And how they feel to the touch. Parchment manuscripts have a distinctive feel. Yes?
But, I mean, late antiquity did have images in them, and you could find your way around these late antique books through the in. And what it seems to me is that what you're talking about here is the rise of ornament in the 7th century.
But very few late antique books, depends on who you ask, but I think very few of them had. Say, and very few of them had a sophisticated and systemic use of ornament that would allow you to find your way around. It's difficult to do. And, you know, it occurs. I mean, there are traces of it. I showed this Coptic thing from maybe the 5th century in Greek with the marginal notation of a peacock. The raw material is there, but to use that so that you're going to know that every chapter is going to begin with something like that. And you can find they're all going to be different, and you can find them. I think that's what we're looking at here.
I would see to you this whole notion of the hierarchy of script and that sort of stuff, which is really what's happening in the 7th century. But since the Augustine Gospel, Gravel Gospel, there's plenty of pictures in, let's call it late antique book illumination, that we help you find your way back.
We can disagree about this. Very special, luxurious books. Often the texts that you're talking about are gospel books. They're for altars. They're not being used regularly for reading. This monastic practice of you get a book and you're supposed to study it, learn it. Weeks from now about Psalter decorations. There's this kind of, to me, cracker dog idea that the Utrecht Psalter was made so that monks could learn how to memorize the Psalms using this pictorial decoration. Incredibly large, magnificent book. And that this would have been a kind of a model for the many, many other books that would be used in the schools to teach kids to read, none of which survive. And if you can imagine with Utrecht Psalter, make me a copy of one of those with your hands, with those drawings. I mean, this was a kind of standard practice, and there were lots of these. It doesn't make any sense to me.
When you first started talking about the Mussoi manuscripts, you devoted real attention to the textual hierarchies and the establishment of the textual hierarchy. As the talk developed, text seemed to drop out in favor of ornaments that you were focusing on were increasingly what I would call kind of carpet patterns, right? Where hierarchy in some way seems to disappear from the ornaments you were looking at. And again, like Anne, I'm thinking aloud, but I'm wondering where you would go if you were spending more time on the text pages.
To a different discipline. No, I'm an art historian. And
but we're talking about visuals of the text pages and how they relate to ways of reading, how the visual enabled ways of reading or tell us something about books.
One of the issues is, what is a disciplinary problem in that this material? Art historians study art, which is often figural, and other people who study manuscripts are interested in the text, and sort of ornament and that kind of thing kind of falls between the two in a way. and hasn't received the kind of sustained attention from both sides that I think it ought to have done. And probably I should have rewritten this lecture for a more textual audience. But it was originally, I felt compelled to the same lecture I gave more or less in London, which was for an art historical audience. But I think you're very right. I focused on what looked like pictures too much.
And non-hierarchical.
And
time for a few more questions.
It's just an addendum to your, yeah, to your, I was just thinking, as you're talking, those are a little bit later than what you're talking about, is layout questions where, let's say, the text of Virgil with a servant's commentary organized around it in such a precise way, you start getting that in the 8th century.
Yeah.
But it shares a layout with, not with Narya, but earlier organized, you know, either double columns or triple columns. And one just wonders, I'm really not asking you, it's just an addendum. I mean, they're textual people look at this and they see it as visual. And so I do just wonder how much the discipline of art history could help textual people, mm-hmm, understand those, yep, very marvelously complicated visuals and also then the relationship between secular and sacred.
It's around the same period you start getting these marginal, the marginal set-asides. What's the chicken and what's the egg? And really luxury manuscripts tend to have really large margins. It's pretty clear in some cases that there's no, this is a gospel book for the altar. They're not making them large margin in order to accommodate a commentary. But clearly somebody's looking at that and sort of seeing, I could really do something with this. And then you get psalters that do have commentary stuck in it. 8th century, and they're often in the similar kind of context. The earliest one I know is, in fact, an Ezekiel manuscript, and which is, you know, the manuscript from St. Petersburg is a commentary on Ezekiel. So there's also a whole level of this is a text that they're interested in, particularly in writing it. But that's another side. My short answer would be no. In that case, but somebody else who knows more about 14th century. Yeah. There are historical events that could be, you know, particular events that could have a major impact. I think the Black Death is not one of them, to the best of my knowledge, at least in the way things would look. It probably raised the wages of a lot of people. And that could have implications for what was being produced.
And I will advise myself two more questions, and this really is it.
To echo the thanks for such a rich talk. My question, I suppose, makes reference, like, almost to the figure that's lacking in your talk, who is Kurt Weitzman, who is, of course, the person who tackled this question deeply. A very different approach, who is interested in reconstructing lost models, because that's where my question will go towards. And the insular tradition is so constructed around the important importation of late antique manuscripts as one of the inspirations for a lot of the mise-en-page that you were focusing on. I just wanted to hear a little bit more about that, I suppose, and also in contrast with what we know for the models for these Gregory texts, and how much is the invention of Betsoi or Bernardaro, and how much is kind of lost models.
Well, Weitzman is mostly talking about figural art, not so much about ornament. But I think the big thing that we're really lacking are the textiles. I think that the means of transmission of ornamental motifs of different sorts, and it's you know, I think I called the most common one in manuscripts is a twist pattern. It's a classic textile pattern. And we have so little, and as we've had some more things, they have often startling similarities to some of the things that we see in manuscripts. There's another kind of codicil to what I presented in the about the barbarian sources, the tendency to see these decorations as based on metalwork prototypes. Because we have metalwork, which is earlier in date, and one sees very little speculation about impact of textiles or other forms on the metalwork. In other words, metalwork is presented as this is ancient Irish or ancient German, and that's the source, the wellspring from which the patterns are transmitted into other designs.
Through climatic accident in Coptic Egypt, they're parsing pretty close.
Yeah, exactly. And there's been a reluctance. I mean, I did an article some years ago about with the Sutton Hoo thing. There's some patterns in there that are absolutely new to the metalwork and cloisonné technique of the early 7th century, and they're importing textile patterns into it, or possibly illumination into it, making this the outcome of a long tradition of metalworking just doesn't work. Thank you. Sure. I've been asked this kind of, what do we replace it with? And what do we replace that art, cultural change and artistic change is produced by new people? Into 25 words or less and put on our syllabus. And I don't have a good answer for it. Probably the real problem is the 25 words or less. It's just really complicated. And rather than, I guess, I try to do, and if you're going to teach this to students, Maeve, help them to really see the particular images that you're showing rather than to insert them into a kind of flashcard version of Western culture. This important book of the early Middle Ages or something like that. They won't remember it anyway. And that's not important. But if you can help them to really see, that may stay with them.
Well, please look at the exhibit, partake of the very generously provided reception, and please let's give a big hand.
Thank you.